Good morning, friends. Happy Easter. Yet. Okay, I didn't hear a word out of this front row. Happy Easter. They all had smiles on their face, I promise. We want to welcome you this morning. My name is Pastor Paula. I am the youth pastor here, and it's so great to be here with you this morning. We get to just worship the God of the universe. We get to worship that the tomb is empty. Amen? All right, so I want to do something fun before we do this out loud. Turn to the person to your right and say, "He is risen." Okay. And turn to the person to the left of you and say, "He is risen indeed." All right, so now we're ready. Now we're ready, right? We have our voices ready. So I am going to say, "He is risen," and you are going to follow with. Okay, but we're going to do it with some oomph, okay? We're going to do it better than if you are at any sporting event cheering the loudest you can cheer. That's how loud we're going to do it, okay? Are we ready? All right. He is risen.
He is risen.
Woo! Okay, I don't think we need to do it a second time. I think they got it. Can you just stand up with us this morning as we get ready to worship the empty tomb, the King? Jesus is King.
Christ the Lord is risen today, hallelujah. Sons of men and angels say, hallelujah. Raise your joys and triumphs high, hallelujah. Sing ye heaven and earth reply, again, our glorious King, hallelujah. Where, O death, is now thy sting, hallelujah. Dying once, He bought the same, hallelujah. Where thy victory, O grave,
alive. Amen.
Amen. He did that. He did all of that for us. We're going to sing Death Was Arrested, and the first part of this song talks about our brokenness and our need of a Savior and how He came so that that part of our life is over and that He comes in and fulfills our life and He can be our Savior.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in when death was arrested and my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given aid. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom He faithfully bore. And He canceled my debt and He called me His friend. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Seated. Good morning. So it's Sunday today, but a couple of days ago, it was Good Friday, and I took a few minutes and did something I don't always do. I read the story of Jesus' death and kind of just sat in that space for a bit. I don't always do that. I have to admit, it's a really tough thing to read about. And what struck me is that it was a tough death, but it was a temporary death. And I had this, the words of this kind of old school pastor that came into my head when he said, "It may be Friday, but Sunday's a coming." And that just kind of kept playing over in my head. And I thought, you know, there's a lot of times in my life where I have a tough set of circumstances. It feels like Friday, but Sunday's a coming. And guess what? It's Sunday. And it's Easter Sunday, maybe the best Sunday of all. So the passage for today is going to come out of Luke 24, 1 through 12. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, he has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, 'The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again.' Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened." We'd like to invite you all today to experience the empty tomb of our living Savior. And our praise team has put together a song that talks about that message and what today is all about.
It's not just about the manger, where the baby lay. It's not all about the angels who sang for him that day. It's not just about the shepherds or the bright and shining star. It's not all about the wise men who traveled from afar.
It's about the cross, it's about my sin, it's about how Jesus came to be born once so that we could be born again. It's about the stone that was rolled away so that you and I could have real life someday. It's about the cross. It's not all about the good things in this life I've done. It's not all about the treasures or the trophies that I've won. It's not about the righteousness that I find within. It's all about his precious blood that saves me from my sin. It's about the cross, it's about my sin, it's about so that we could be born again. It's about the stone that was rolled away so that you and I could have real life someday. It's about the cross. The beginning of the story is wonderful and great, but it's the ending that can save you, and that's why we celebrate. It's about the cross. It's about my sin. It's about how Jesus came to be born once so that we could be born again. It's about God's Son nailed to a tree. It's about how every drop of blood that flowed from Him when it should have been me. It's about the stone that was rolled away. It's about you and I could have real life someday. So that you and I could have real life someday. It's about the cross. It's about the cross. It's about the cross.
We're going to continue worshiping. Would you stand and worship with us again? One day when heaven was filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is He. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, His glory revealed. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led Him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed Him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He. The hand that healed nations, stretched out on a tree, and took the nails for me. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose, over death he had conquered. Now he's ascended, my Lord evermore. But death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him from rising again. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day.
Lining the stage, as you often see churches have on Easter, we have all these lilies. We do something unique on Easter at this church. Each one of these lilies, and there were more that were taken away after first service, but each one of these lilies represents someone who had a faith in Jesus who has passed from this life. A family member, a close friend, someone who had a faith in Jesus who has died. And this is a day where we remember those who had a faith in Christ, who have passed on, because what better day to remember those who have died than the day we celebrate that Jesus rose from the dead, conquering death, and when we put our faith in him, death is not permanent, amen? And so that's why we are going to take a moment in this service and just remember some people that were special to us, that are now with Jesus on this Resurrection Sunday. From Diana Horn, in memory of Ida Mae Horn, mother. From Gordon Miller, in memory of Naomi Miller, wife. From the Puentes family, in memory of Samantha and Ukiah, sister and nephew. From the Puentes Scott family, in memory of Sharon Boardman, grandmother. From Bob and Meredith Wadlow, in memory of Bonnie Bryden, friend. And from Bob and Meredith Wadlow, in memory of Janice Waringen, friend. From the Hill and Wynn families, in memory of Brian Hill, husband, father, son, and brother. And from the Hill and Wynn families, in memory of Travis Hill, husband, father, grandfather. From Judy Thornhill, in memory of Clarence and Evelyn Deneen, parents. From Rolando Paleo, in memory of Juliana Paleo, mother. From Pamela Paleo, in memory of Orvin and Barbara Smith, parents. From Rolando and Pamela Paleo, in memory of Roella Jean Paleo, daughter. From Bruce Heilman, in memory of Ed and Vonnie Heilman, parents. From Marla Heilman, in memory of Paul, a G father. From Sandra Wylie, in memory of Ted Wylie, husband and my uncle. From Sandra Wylie, in memory of Teddy Wylie, her son, my cousin. From Sandra Wylie, in memory of Dale C. Merrill, Jr., her brother. And from Sandra Wylie, in memory of Dale C. Merrill, Sr., father. From the Steinbrink family, Leonard Steinbrink, Shiloh's grandfather. From Red and Ann Phelps, in memory of June Phillips and Ruth Thistle, Ann's mother and grandmother. From the Federhoff family, in memory of Carrie and Jim Sherman, Ricky's parents. From the Federhoff family, in memory of A.J. Sherman, Ricky's son. From the Federhoff family, in memory of Grandma Gladys, Spencer's grandmother. And from the Federhoff family, in memory of Legend DeRay, nephew. From Becky Topp, in memory of Dennis Topp, husband. From Chelsea White, in memory of Carolyn Wood, mother. From Randy and Kelly Thompson, in memory of Trudy Wilson, mother. From Kathy Yates, in memory of Brenda Collins, friend. And from Kathy Yates, in memory of Phyllis Fifield, friend. From the Wylie family, in memory of Rex Pixley, my grandpa. And from the Wylie family, in memory of Pastor Larry Underwood, Denise's father. From the Sheffield family, in memory of Dave and Margaret Quinby, Jerry Ann's parents. And from the Sheffield family, in memory of Ted and Mary Geck, Randy's aunt and uncle. From Diane Sanders, in memory of Gene Sanders, husband. And from Diane Sanders, in memory of Luella Barnes, mother. From Kiri, Sarah, and Kiri Kennedy, in memory of Billy and Walter Kennedy, grandparents. From Pete and Shelley Torres, in memory of Joan Torres, Pete's mother. And from Pete and Shelley Torres, in memory of Shirley Kleinow, Shelley's mother. From Doug and Carol Miller, in memory of Kathy Walker, Carol's sister. From Thomas and Xu Ying Sheffield, in memory of Elizabeth Ann Sheffield, mother and grandmother. And from Thomas and Xu Ying Sheffield, in memory of Leonard William Sheffield, father and grandfather. From Shauna Riley, in memory of Ricky Bubba Herrera, son. And from Bartolo Herrera, in memory of Bart Herrera, son. And from Carol Mork and family, in memory of Charlie Mork, husband, father, and grandfather. This morning when I got here early, I opened up these shades right here, and the sun was just right through the window, and just a shaft of light went all the way down the row. And I turned on some lights and did things, and I came back in, and you could just see they perked up. The light was feeding them life. And we just read the names of people who had faith in Jesus Christ. And I tell you what, there is no death for those people. The light of the world, Jesus, is feeding them life. And one day, if you have a faith in Jesus, death will not be permanent for you, but you will spend an eternity of that light of Jesus giving you life. And so we're going to sing a song as we just honored those who have gone to be with the Lord, a song that reminds us that we too will rise with them as Jesus gives us life.
Mm-hmm.
There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. And I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. Would you stand and sing with us? Cause there's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light, and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won, and he is risen from the dead. I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise.
As we were singing that song, I don't know about you, but I remember when the tomb being empty became real for me. Can we just bow our heads this morning and pray, praising God? Lord, we thank you for this time that we can come together and worship you. Lord, I pray this morning that each and every one of us, through the power of your Holy Spirit, would grasp the understanding of that tomb being empty. That the chains are broken, Lord, whether it be shame, whether it be depression, anxiety, guilt, all of those things that aren't from you, Lord. May we grasp that. That the tomb is empty, Lord, because he has risen. And because of that, Lord, we can spend eternity with you. And so, Lord, I pray this morning, I pray that your voice be the loudest voice heard in this building. That, Lord, every fiber of every cell of every being, of every spirit, of every soul in this place, Lord, through the power of your Spirit, would know that you are here and that your love, your redemption, Lord, is real. Is so real. We thank you, Lord. We praise your name, for it's in your glory, your honor, your praise. The Son of Jesus Christ, the name above all names, the name that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that you are Lord. Amen. Amen. If you can remain standing for the reading of God's word. Last service I said remain seating, but I really was standing, so. We're going to go with standing, okay? From the Gospel of John. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and he believed. You may be seated.
Heavenly Father, as we go to your word, Father, maybe some of us, as of a day ago, didn't realize we'd be sitting right here, right now. But Lord, I pray that every person in here will be open to their Creator speaking to them. Maybe they don't anticipate that or think that will happen, Lord. Father, I just ask that you are given an audience this morning by each one of us, in Jesus' name, amen. It was the mid-90s, and I was in my university's computer lab, and I was on a computer. Computers were kind of a new thing. Now, they had been around for a while, but they were just becoming a thing. People were finally throwing away the typewriters and the word processors. Remember those horrible things? And the world was switching to computers. We were investigating this internet thing and learning what to do on there. And it really worked for college students because they had printers and computers. You could type your papers real easy. You could research and type at the same time on these computers. And I had an email even. Yeah, I was big time. I had an email through College Club. Maybe some of you remember College Club. But it gave free email to college people, and that's the price I was looking for. And when I was checking my email, yep, they already had banner ads going on, and there was an ad that College Club was hiring college students to chat for $15 an hour, to chat in their chat room. In the mid-90s, that was a lot for a college student. And I'm like, wow, I'm going to check this out. Let's see if they're hiring in San Diego where I was. They were. They had an office there. And long story short, I set up an interview, went in for an interview. I brought the one tie I brought from home. I wore that. This is the same one. No, it's not the same one. I wore a tie, went in, met this guy in a full suit. He was really happy, really excited. I shook his hand. I made a joke. He laughed. Man, this is going to be a piece of cake. We go into his office. We sit down. He's got a pad, a paper, and a pen. And he's all, okay, let's get started. First off, tell me, what kind of computer do you have? And I said, I don't have a computer. In fact, in my whole hall at college, there was only one guy who had a computer. Like, no one had, college students didn't have computers yet. And I said, I don't have a computer. And he's like, oh. And I explained to him about the computer lab and how I could go in there and how I used it. And he's all, oh, how many hours a day do you spend in the computer lab? And I'm thinking, I probably spend 2 hours a week in the computer lab. And I kind of hem and haw, and, you know, his enthusiasm died. The pencil and pad went back on his desk. He never wrote one thing down the entire interview. And it was kind of a formality, and at the end of the interview, he says, okay, we'll let you know. Well, you don't have to, because I already know. After one question, I knew I wasn't getting that job. Just one question determined everything. And I'm here to tell you, on Easter Sunday, there is a question that all of us must answer that will determine everything. A question that each one of these people that these lilies were dedicated to, their life has now been completed here on earth. And there was a question they had to answer that determines everything now. And in your life, you must answer this question. It's an essential question. It's a question about Jesus, and the answer is crucial, and it deals with seeing, but seeing is relative. Like, how two people see the same thing can be totally different. For example, if I am driving when my kids were smaller, and they're in the back, and I saw a deer on the side of the road, I would turn to my kids and say, hey, girls, look out the window, there's a deer, and they go, oh, and all that kind of stuff, and look at it. Now, some of you Oregonians, if dad is driving down the road and sees a deer, he turns to his kid and says, pass up the rifle, you know, and the kid loads it, locks it, and hands it up. See, two total different ways of seeing the same object. Seeing is not the same for everyone, depending on what it is we're seeing, and I'm telling you, how you see Jesus could be completely different than the person sitting next to you right now. How do you see Jesus? That's the question we all must answer in our life, is how do you truly see Jesus? And it's kind of fascinating to some that that passage, that short passage that Paul had just read, those few verses, there is this verb that it says they saw, they looked. And that word keeps coming up for each person in those passages with Mary and John and Peter. They saw, they looked. And that verb to see, do you realize they use three different words to see in that same passage? See, the New Testament was written in ancient Greek, not the Greek that's around today, but ancient Greek, that's a dead language. In fact, there are some words we don't even know what they mean. But it was written in this ancient Greek, and the ancient Greek had multiple words for seeing based on what kind of seeing it was. We just say, see, I see this, and based on the sentence, we got to figure out what kind of seeing you're doing. But here in the Greek, there's three kinds of seeing, and I know that right now, you're seeing Jesus like one of those three words. And I'm going to tell you what those three are. And that's the question today, is how are you seeing Jesus? Let me tell you the first way to see Jesus. It's in verse 1 and it's in verse 5. And we see Mary saw that the stone had been removed. That's the verb to see. And John bent over and looked to see at the strips. The same Greek word is used for both of those. And it is, they didn't enter the tomb, but they're seeing, they're inspecting things outside the tomb. And the word is blepe. Say blepe. You all sound like Greek scholars. Good job. Blepe means to observe, to notice, to become aware of something. You step outside your house to go to work in the morning or to go to school, and a car drives by and you recognize the car, it's the person down the street. You just blepe'd that car. You noticed it. It's just something you notice. That's it. It's just, oh, I recognize that car. That's it. It's to observe, to notice, to become aware of something. They became aware that the stone had moved. They became aware that the grave linens were there, but there was no body. They saw it. They observed it from a distance. They didn't go in. They had kind of an outsider's view of what was going on. Some of us in this room, we blepe Jesus. We kind of have an outsider's view. We know some things. We would never claim to know everything about Jesus. Yeah, I don't know everything he taught. I know about him being on a cross. I don't fully know all the details about that or what it meant or how it totally works, but I know he died. I know on Easter we're singing about him rise again. I've got some snapshots. I know some basic facts. I've watched a few videos online, or someone's told me about it before. And the way I see Jesus today is in little, just kind of, I observe, like I had a funeral for one of my relatives and there was a pastor up there, opened the Bible and read some verses. I went to a wedding that had a pastor and they read some verses. You know, I was watching the Super Bowl and there was a commercial about Jesus. You know, I get little snapshots. There's a Bible in my house that someone had given us. Every now and then I see that Bible and I think, oh yeah, that's about God. But it's just a distant, limited view. And that's how you see Jesus. Blepe. Some of us, our view of Jesus is just from a distance, a snapshot. That's one of them. The other one, the next one is in verse 6, where it says that he saw the strips of linen. See, Peter actually went into the tomb. He got a closer view than Mary and John. So it's a closer view than just observing or noticing. This word is theore. Say theore. Theore means to view and to take in, to behold something. It means to spectate. So it's not just noticing something, you're beholding, you're spectating. It's like when you go see a play or go to the movies. You don't just notice the movie. No, it beholds your attention. You're expecting. You're taking it in. You're observing. That's what this theore. You go to a play. You sit in a theore to watch the play. What do you think word came from theore? Theater. You're sitting. You're viewing. You see the parts. You see the details. You see the pieces. You're familiar with the story, but nothing beyond that. You're not involved in it. No one wants someone to go to the movies and they stand up and start quoting the lines with the movie. No. You sit and you spectate. No one, if I go to Cats, I don't want someone to put ears on and jump up on stage from the crowd. You don't participate. You go and you spectate. You observe, nothing beyond that. You're a viewer. That's how some of us see Jesus. We theore Jesus. We spectate. We're familiar with the story. Maybe we understand the story. Maybe we understand the message of the Bible. Maybe we understand his teachings. We've seen what he's about, theore. We've spectated. Maybe we had a childhood where we grew up in the church and we were told the information. But it stopped there. we never moved past just being a spectator. We were a part, but we weren't involved. Our heart was not involved. There are some people that even sit in the church regularly that do not move past just being a viewer. That's how they see Jesus. Doesn't result to any action. Doesn't result to any results. It doesn't move when they leave the theater. Then there's nothing there. Seeing Jesus without participating beyond what you've seen. So seeing Jesus from a distant, limited view, or seeing Jesus without participating. Then there's a third way of seeing. This final third way. John saw and believed. See, this kind of seeing is totally different. It means to perceive. It's like when you say, I see what you mean. When you tell someone, I see what you mean, is that about your eyes or is that about your mind? It's about your mind. I see what you're doing. I see what's going on here. It's about seeing something, yes, but it's more about perceiving, understanding, coming to a realization. This word to see is eiden. Can you say eiden? Eiden means to perceive, to understand, to have a realization. You're no longer just viewing something. Now you're participating because it is changing your mindset. It is changing how you think. There's going to be a reaction. And it says John, you can see his reaction. He saw, he eiden, he realized, he understood. The understanding came and then he believed. And I tell you, in the Bible, you think of John 3:16, the most famous verse, for whoever believes in Jesus, that doesn't mean just thinking Jesus exists. That's not what that believe means. The believe means it's an active belief. If I said I believe in recycling, am I saying I believe recycling exists? No. If I say I believe in recycling, that means I believe you should recycle. If I said I believe in recycling, but you saw me dumping cans in the regular trash can, do I really believe in recycling? That's the kind of belief when it says whoever believes in Jesus. That's the kind of belief that John is having. Not just, I think Jesus exists, but it's this understanding and is this response. It's I see Jesus. I know Jesus. I believe. I follow Jesus. And when you see Jesus like this, it changes everything. How do you see Jesus today? Is he just something you notice from time to time, you observe from time to time? Is he just something you spectate? You kind of know the players, the pieces, but you're kind of just observing without participation and following him? Do either of those seeing say, Jesus is Lord of my life? They don't. Can either of those approaches say that Jesus is Lord of your life? Can either of those approaches claim that you're a follower of Jesus? Are either of those capable of belief? Not just believing something is true, but wholeheartedly supporting believing, true belief. And maybe you're sitting here and saying, well, I am one of the first two. I don't think I'm participating in a life with Jesus. I don't see him that way. I don't participate with a relationship with him or repeated prayer with him or reading about him or going to church and being a part of what he called his bride. I don't really see Jesus that way, but I do believe he exists, or maybe it's just, I don't even sure about that. I know about him. I see them from a distance, or I just kind of spectate, but I don't get involved. If that's you, maybe you would wonder, how do I start to see Jesus differently? How can I see Jesus like that E-Aiden? How can I, like, understand and lead me to real belief? How can I get there? How can I see him differently than what I'm so used to? In order to see Jesus like that, you need to E-Aiden, you need to perceive and understand how Jesus sees you. In order to see Jesus like John saw Jesus, you have to understand how Jesus sees you. That is so important with truly seeing and believing in Jesus. You have to know how he sees you. And there's actually a verse that shows this in a few verses after what Paula read. Basically, we have one of the most embarrassing moments in the Bible. Mary is distraught, upset, bless her heart. She sees a man outside the tomb, and she thinks it's the gardener. Now, I respect gardeners. Gardeners are some of the hardest working people I've ever seen. But come on, Jesus just died on the cross, took all the sins of the world, was dead, went to the pit of hell for 3 days, and now has rose again and conquered sin and death. And the first person that sees him thinks he's picking weeds. That's what's going on here. And she sees him, thinks he's the gardener, and says, "Sir, what have you done with the body of Jesus?" And Jesus sees this moment happening. And you know when Mary started to Aiden? Do you know when she started to perceive and understand and believe that she was talking to Jesus? It's in this little verse in verse 16. I'm just showing you the part. Jesus said to her, "Mary." And that changed how she saw Jesus, because Jesus knew her name. And if you want to know how you can see Jesus in a way that leads to belief, you must understand how Jesus sees you. He knows your name. Jesus isn't a God of the masses. He knows your name because he created you. He knows you. He knows what you've done. He's known what you've struggled with. He knows what tears you up inside. He knows the anxiety. He knows the deep-seated sadness and depression. But he knows the beautiful person he made you to be. He was there from the beginning. He knows your name. He's not some God of the masses. He's not a God of some political party. He's not a God of certain countries. Jesus is the creator, and he knows your name. And when we say we see Jesus, we don't see the Christian God. We see the one who knows us better than anyone. How many people in your life really, really know you? Even the people you love the most, even close family or close friends, they know you, but they don't know all of you. Jesus is the only one who really knows you, knows everything, and he loves you, and he still died for you, and he still knows your name, and he still calls you by name. That's how Jesus sees you. Do you see a Jesus that sees you like that? Have you ever? Have you ever tried to pray to a God like that? Have you ever asked for comfort for a God like that? Have you ever reached out in the darkness of night to a God like that, who knows you, created you, loves you, despite anything and everything you've ever done? He sees you. He knows you. when I was just a few months later than that job interview, I made some colossal mistakes in my life. Mistakes that I didn't know what my future would hold. I was thinking I would have to drop out of college. I was thinking that any kind of future plans I had were ruined. I didn't know what my family would treat me like. I thought they were going to be disappointed in me in life. I had no clue what to do. I had no clue how to fix it. I had no clue even what to do the next day in my life. It's like these mistakes I made came crashing in on me all at the same time while I'm a college student, and I didn't know what to do, and I didn't know where to go. And I'll never forget, I went out just to this hill that was overlooking the ocean at my school, and I stared out there, and I just felt like I had absolutely no future. And in that darkness, I had no call to ministry. I had no direction whatsoever in my life. And in that darkness, that was my own doing, Jesus called my name. And I'm not saying he said my name out loud. I just knew he was there, and I knew he knew everything I was feeling. And I had to choose to either ignore that or just run to that. And by the grace of God, I chose to run to it. And then he gave me a future. He gave me the steps I needed. He built the bridges I needed in my life. He loved me despite my mistakes. And eventually, and I never would have guessed it, he said, I want you to be a minister and tell others that I do this. You see, me and Jesus, we're on a first name basis. And I tell you what, I grew up in the church. But I never really knew what that meant until that moment in my darkness. And I tell you what, you can see Jesus in a way where you know you're on a first name basis, that he sees right where you're at. And when you see Jesus like that, nothing is ever the same. Yeah, there's still hurt and pain in this world. But any depression or anxiety or anger you face in this life, when you know Jesus knows your name and what that means, it's different. There's always hope. There's always a joy amongst the sadness, depression, or anger. He knows your name. There's a song that goes, I have a maker, he formed my heart. Before even time began, my life was in his hands. He knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call. Have you ever seen Jesus like that before? Before you breathe your last breath, that's the question you must answer. Have you ever given Christ a chance? We give a lot of things chances in this world. Have you ever truly given Christ a chance to show you how he sees you and to see him for who he is? Maybe you never have. Maybe some of you have seen Jesus like that before, but if you're honest, and I don't care how long you've been a Christian or how long you've come to church, maybe some of you, you've gone from the belief John had, that participating belief, you've sat down as a spectator. You don't put yourself out there. You just kind of sit down and see what's for me instead of truly believing in Jesus. I'm going to ask if you just stand where you're at. I'm going to invite you to not sit outside the tomb spectating. Not sit outside the tomb just noticing Jesus. I'm going to invite you to come into the tomb and see and know and believe. See how Jesus sees you. Easter, March 31st, 2024. Could be the day that you see Jesus differently, or you return to seeing Jesus how he deserves to be seen. Could be the day you stop betting on the things of the world that are giving you comfort and getting you by, and you bet on the one who rose and died for you and will give you eternal life. And that's not a bet, it's not a gamble. It's just giving him the opportunity to show you how he sees you. Is that a new step for you? Is that something you must return to? And pastors always say, hey, come up forward and kneel at the altar. And do you have to do that? No, but you know why we say that? Because that's the kind of belief where there's participation. It goes beyond spectating. It's where it's just like you have to be moved. So I'm going to ask you, would you bow your heads right now? Is he calling your name? Not in a voice that can be heard, but in your heart and soul that he created. Is he letting you know right now he knows you and he wants you to see him? I would invite you to step into the tomb, come kneel at this altar, and just pray in the most simple way, Jesus, help me see you for who you really are. You come forward. Others have already come. Holy Spirit just started early, and I praise the Lord for that. Do you need to see Jesus for who he is? Are you willing to step forward, or do you stay spectating? Do you stay outside the tomb? I just say, just come now. Step now. Don't hesitate. Don't listen to the world. Don't listen to me. Don't think about what should I do this or should I? What are people going to think? If he's calling your name, don't you ever get used to rejecting his voice when he calls your name. If he calls your name, you say yes right now. Come and kneel and pray that you can see him. You come right now. I'm going to be quiet in this moment. If he's calling you by name, step out. Take that step of faith and believe. Some that hesitated at first, just like you, but they came and they kneeled. And what they're finding kneeling before Jesus through a true act of faith is something you can't find anywhere else but in the life-giving blood of Jesus. Anyone else that he's just calling, come forward. He wants so bad for you to see him for what he did for you and what he will do for you. You come. While these at the altar pray, I'm going to close in prayer. And maybe you've got a battle within. Maybe you just don't know. maybe parts of you are just fighting. Maybe you're just swallowed in some darkness like I was. Just know when you walk out this door, Jesus is going to be calling. When you lay down in bed tonight, Jesus is going to be calling. This ain't over for him. Be open. Let this be a step in that direction. Father, on this Resurrection Sunday, it's the same power that rose Jesus from the dead. It's that same Spirit that is here now. And I pray that those kneeling know that Jesus sees them clearly and wants a life with them where they are seeing Jesus and Jesus is seeing them. Father, may this just be a step closer to you. Father, let them know right now you are pleased and you are here. And no darkness, no nothing can hold back the love of Jesus. Father, I pray that this is a life-changing day. And Father, if there's a person in this crowd that questions, I pray that they take a step and talk to someone. Ask those questions. And don't resist the voice calling to them. Lord, may those of us who have seen you, may the act of celebration, Resurrection Sunday, may it solidify our view as we keep our eyes focused on Christ. This day is his and only his. We pray and we dismiss in the name of the risen Lord Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Hey, he is risen. Go with the Lord. Be blessed. You're dismissed. Hey, test 1, 2. Test 1, 2. Test 1, 2. Oh, it's on there. Don't forget to get your lily. If you made a lily dedication, make sure you take your lily home.